Welcome back to our course on mechanical behavior and testing of materials. Now, in this lecture, which belongs to the introductory module, we will be discussing about history of material testing. Now, the utilitarians among you might wonder what purpose would a lecture something like this serve in a course wherein our focus is to understand the behavior of a material under an imposed mechanical condition. You might wonder why should one survey the history of material testing? The answer to that question is manifold. If you look around, all you have to do is look around you to see that we are in the middle of a technological evolution. Even though this evolution in technology nowadays it is largely confined to the information realm, it was not so always. Few decades before, one could visibly see the change in the technology that one is using. With this evolution of or with this technological development, the need for materials or appropriate materials also changed. So, in order to cater to that need, metallurgical and materials engineers were forced to develop appropriate testing tools. So, when one surveys the history of material testings, all he is doing is keeping up with the evolution or the technological evolution. Now, even though we will not be going in this particular lecture, we will not be going into each and every development or the technological development that relates to material testing, we will be focusing on some of the prominent ones. Now, the other aspect, at least to my understanding, why one should consider surveying the history of material testing, it helps us relate our course to the practical application. It often happens, particularly in a hugely theoretical course like this, that we are so focused on what you are learning in the behavior of materials or what are the factors that undergird them or the theory behind it, we at times lose sight of the end of it. Or what purpose does this hall serve? The whole picture is sometimes lost to us. Now, when we have a lecture like this on the history of material testing, it helps us to be in balance. It helps us to keep that picture of application in line with us, and we can discuss accordingly. Now, in the philosophical side of things, even though we are much interested in machine learning, I personally, as an instructor of this course, would not want you to learn like machines. So what I mean by that is, machines nowadays, they are capable of handling huge chunk of data. We have taught them to handle huge chunk of data, which are generally multidimensional in nature. It is sometimes not really capable for us to imagine the nature of these data, but machine can do that. Not only they can handle, have them or they can store them, they can handle them, they can analyze them, and they can also find a definite pattern in them. We have taught machines to do that. And supposing you pose a question to that machine regarding this pattern, and based on the pattern that it has developed, it might be able to give you an answer or predict a behavior. So machines have evolved this much that they are able to understand, not only understand the question, but they are able to give you an answer that is predictive in nature. If we are doing the same, like we are understanding the mechanical behavior, in the sense we are collecting the data and we process the data, and all we are at the end trying to do is give a predictive answer to a set of questions, all we are doing is we are learning like machines. This is not what I want you to do as an instructor of this course. I want you to have not only a feel for the subject, but also appreciate how we came to this place where we are in now. Supposing in a laboratory today, if you are handling a universal testing machine, it would be nice to know what are the factors that contributed to the building up of this machine that is before you today that you are now planning to handle. Now, after all, when Newton attributes his work as standing on the shoulders of the giant, he recognized who these giants were. And we should not be so much application oriented or so much utilitarian in our thoughts that we sometimes forget who these giants are, forget their works. So let enough of such pontification. So let us get into this lecture. For this lecture, I will be usually relying on the work of Chester H. Gibbons. He has presented an article wherein he has tried to compile the history of testing, material testing. Now, yes, this lecture, this article rather, is wonderfully written, and he has held the name Gibbons. I would be really happy if you are acquainted with the work of the other Gibbons, Richard Gibbons. After all, this is this lecture touches upon history, so I'll be really happy if you just know who Richard Gibbons is or what his works are. Now, in this lecture, we will not be focusing on everyone who actually thought of material testing. We will not be doing that. We will be focusing on, taking a cue from Chester H. Gibbons, we will be focusing on those researchers who have actually not only conceived material testing, but they have practiced it. They had a purpose and they had a setup, they have built a setup and they had some results and they have used it in some application. When you check all these boxes, only these researchers we will be focusing in this lecture. So let us begin. So this man is reportedly the first one to do an extensive testing of materials for a practical purpose. You can pause a moment, take a look at him and guess who he is, or we can go ahead with the lecture. Now, if you have paused, if you have guessed, yes, it is none other than Galileo Galilei. He is known as the father of modern physics, or generally as father of modern science. Now, it is reported that prior to 1638, he has done some experiments on testing of materials. So, the material he focused on was copper, particularly in the form of rods or strings. You might wonder, this great mathematician, astronomer, what purpose or why, what is the need for him to do a testing on the strength of copper rods or strings. Now, the answer to that question is, if you look, if you have a look at his telescope, you would find why or what is the need for such a testing. Now, the way or the approach that he used to test his copper rods was rather simple. All he did was hang a weight at the bottom of this of his copper rods or strings. And he kept on adding weight till the copper rod failed. Now, the reason why he wanted to do such a strength analysis of copper in particular is because this is his telescope and it comprises of wood and copper. Now, the copper, he used copper strings to held and of course mirrors, it was a part of his telescope. And now, he used copper strings to hold both to hold the wood tubes together. So, depending on the strength of the copper rods, the structure of the telescope varied. Now, when you have high strength material holding your telescope, it means that your telescope is more sturdy, and he wanted to use such a high strength material, and after a certain degree of research, he was able to come settle down with copper strings, and this certain degree of research involved testing the strength of copper. Now, following Galileo in his search for the strength of copper rods using a simple dead weights, we had to wait for like close to 100 years or a century till the next researcher came who worked extensively on testing of materials. And that researcher is Professor Peter van Muysenbroek. So he is like many researchers back then. He was a mathematician. He was involved in medicine. He was also an astronomer to some degree. Now, he in his research not only built a machine for testing of materials, but he also conceived different forms of testings. So here is some of the images from his original works. As you can see, he thought of building different tools for material testing, and he successfully built one for tensile testing, as you could see here. Now, he largely worked on woods, and here you could see him dabbling with the failure analysis of woods. Now he is credited with building a first that is a first that is vaguely some sort of a tensile machines that we use today. And his work, or the reason why he built such testing machine, was he wanted to see the coherence of materials. Now, if you are wondering what he meant by coherence of materials, is what we today refer to it as strength of materials. Now, when you are thinking about, or when you come across the word strength of materials, or if you are taking a course, or if you have already taken up a course on strength of materials, remember that it starts with Professor Peter here and his works on testing of materials. And here what you have again is some sort of a dead weight arrangement, and here the focus is not on exactly the behavior of material, but the failure of it, and he largely focused on woods. Now both these researchers, both Galileo and Professor Peter, both these researchers, they built their machine out of their own individualist interest. They had their own research focus, and they built a machine based on it. There was no public announcement of it, or not many were interested in it. Now this all changed in 1770s when architect John Rudolf Peyronet, of France, when he wanted to build a bridge over Siena at Neuilly. And when he wanted to build this bridge, he wanted to make sure that he used a right set of materials, and he wanted to be sure about the sturdiness or the strength of this materials. And for that, he built a testing machine. And this is the time, particularly in France, this was the time when the shift was made from a private interest in testing of materials to a public interest. And funds were being allocated for building up the material testings, and because now the application side of it was huge. Earlier, the application was just to understand in an abstract manner the test, the strength of materials, but now the understanding of strength of materials was being translated into an application, and that too a building of bridge across a river. And now based on his testing machine, several other testing machines were made around the same era in France, and one of those machines was made by Lombardi, and this was a huge machine that could handle a capacity that could handle a weight of 100 tons. And this huge machine was first used, or this was the first machine that was inspired by architect Peyronet, and which was then constructed by Lombardi. This huge machine was the first to be involved in experimental studies on elasticity of materials. Now, the machine that was first conceived for a public application of building a bridge, this motivated in the construction of even bigger machine around the same time period in France, that was ultimately used to do some experimental works on elasticity of the materials. And one thing that evolved during this period was the capacity of the machine. Even though architect Peyronet, he did not use 100 tons machine, but his idea helped Lombardi to build such a huge machine. Now the second set of evolution, or when we move in this history of material testing, the next step comes in England. In England, around 1779, the Iron Bridge, which is even existing today, it was completed. This bridge was the main component for building this bridge was cast iron. And even though there is not much explicit reports on how well this cast iron was tested, it is often claimed that such a bridge would not have been built without any exclusive testing of the materials that were involved. Therefore, it is included in the history of material testing that during the building of this bridge, there should have been, or that might there might have been, an extensive testing of materials, or the testing of materials would have been a critical part in building this iron bridge, a famous one which is around with us even today. Now, even though there is not much documented results of the material involved in this bridge, we have around the same period the works of George and Robert Stephenson. George Stephenson, he is the father of railways, And when he wanted to choose the right material for building railway bridges, it is reported that he involved several professors to do several testings on particularly cast and wrought iron. And it was found that based on the testing of materials, it was found that the cast iron would be more appropriate for building railway bridges. Now if you could recapitulate, we began with something of a private interest, then we moved to a public interest of building a bridges, and now we have moved into a realm wherein we are thinking about building railway bridges. And for that railway bridges, we are doing now an extensive testing of materials. Now the next step for the testing of materials comes from George Rennie. Now he is a mechanical engineer, and in the year 1870s, he was assigned to work on the railway locomotive, not the structural tracks, but the locomotives. And unlike the tracks, wherein the loads are rather definite, which we have to largely focus on the tensile loading, in case of locomotive, the loads that the locomotives experienced were rather convoluted. So he was forced to develop a machine that was not only capable of imposing a tensile load, but was capable of including a torsion load as well. So he was the first one to develop a torsion testing machine. Now the transition from a tensile testing machine to a torsion testing machine came through the application of building a railway locomotive. Now this application forced the a shift in the testing of materials, and now the focus, at least for George Rennie, was torsion. Now around the same period in England, there was another person, William Williams, who in 1829 developed a similar testing machine wherein the load was pretty high. He developed a machine which had the capacity of handling 130 tons. Now, even though this is something new or one of the advancement, the major advancement of his machine, which is shown here, is that it not only tested the material, but it tested materials that were joined. Generally, all the previous testings involved a simple homogeneous material. So they had the capacity to test only a simple homogeneous material. But the machine developed by William Williams, it was aimed to test the materials which were joined together. Like these materials were either riveted or bolted joints, and he wanted to test the strength of these joints. And so he built a machine that was not only huge, but had the capacity of being included in a setup. And and this setup, which had the capability of encompassing a sample that was not homogeneous but joint. Now there is a wonderful comment made for the machine developed by William Williams, and this comment can be read here. So this comment states that this machine is the first one to use all the essential principles that all the modern machines have, or they should have. So in addition to have the capability of handling the materials that are joined, this machine had adapted the concept, or was the first one to develop the concepts that are being still used in the approved and modern day machines. Now away from England, and just around the same period, we have the USA come into play. Now in 1832 to 1837, the US Treasury Department allocated a huge amount of money in order to develop testing equipments, particularly for to address the problem of explosion of boilers. So they were investigating to build a boiler system that was that should behave in an appropriate manner at high temperature. It should not explode in like unexpected moments. So they were working on these boilers, and they wanted to make sure that they have the right material for it. And for that, they allocated a large amount of fund in order to develop a testing machine that not only could impose mechanical condition, but also could increase the ambient temperature. And so they developed the first a machine wherein you can increase the temperature of the specimen when you test its tensile strength. Now this machine is the pioneer for today's high temperature tensile testing machine. And the reason that this machine came into being is because they wanted to test or cater the need for the cater the material needs of the boilers. Now, another development that happened in United States was before that, this machine is still available with us, and it is serviceable, meaning it is possible for us to run some experiments in this machine that was commissioned in around 1830s. Now, the other progress that happened around the same period in United States happened in the year 1850. Now, in this year, West Point Foundry, they developed a machine that was rather universal in nature. Nowadays, our testing machines, they are not only have the capability of tensile testing, but they have the capability of doing compression and also torsion. And this, the modern day universal testing machine, the father of this modern day universal testing machine, was developed in this West Point Foundry at around 1850. And this universal testing machine became the first step towards what we now refer to as commercial mechanical laboratories. Now, even today, it is not necessary for us to own a universal testing machine, or it's not necessary for us to own a tensile testing machine. We have dedicated labs wherein the whole purpose is to test the materials that we give to them. So this development in West Point Foundry is the pioneer for such independent and commercial mechanical laboratories. Now, the other focus, or a shift in the focus for material testing, again came in US, and this was in the year 1872. Now, if you read the article by Gibbons, he states that 1872 is one of the important years in the history of material testing. This is because in this year, the focus shift from the type of loading condition, from the amount of load a machine could handle, from all those aspects, the focus shifted from precision testing. This is because in the United States, people wanted to develop a database for all the steel and iron that were available to them. So in order to build such a database, they wanted a precision testing machine, and this was commissioned, or funding for a board for developing such a machine was commissioned in the year 1872. And A.H. Emery was the one who was contracted for this job of developing a precision testing machine. Now, his work was so wonderful that it is interesting to read the comments from the board that assigned him this work. As you can see here, the report from the board is this: for the machine that was constructed by A.H. Emery, the machine is more perfect than we had any right to expect from the terms of the contract. So what they mean by that is, even though they had some vague idea about how much of a precision they need in their testing machine, A.H. Emery was able to build a machine that is shown here that succeeded, or that not only fulfilled their expectation, but it superseded their expectation. Now, how precise was this machine, you might ask, Gibbons has wonderfully documented it for us. Now, the precision of this machine is expressed in this way: when they took like 7 readings of a load of 100 pounds, the precision was close to this. You could take time to read this. And when they increased the load, when they increased the number of readings, the precision also accordingly increased. So they were elated by the degree of precision that was AHMRI was able to provide to them. Now, in this lecture or in the brief history that we have been looking into, we have seen there is a continual shift in the focus. We saw that the initial testing machine were rather confined to a particular individual or his own interest in his research, and then it moved to a public interest when it was involved in building bridges, be it normal bridges or railway bridges, and the focus there was more on how much of a load can I impose using this machine. And then now we have come into a period in history wherein the focus has shifted to precision. And the final piece of this history wherein there has been a drastic change made is was a result of an unfortunate Quebec bridge disaster. And this bridge was actually being built over St. Lawrence River. And during the construction of this bridge, there was an unfortunate disaster, and close to 80 people, particularly the ones who were working on this bridge, they lost their lives. And in order to be more sure about the materials that we use in the construction of the bridge, or the components that we use in the construction of the bridge, the subsequent works in material testing involved building a machine that wherein you could directly include the component in it and test it. So usually when you have a testing machine, all you would do is take the material that is up that you want to use in a particular application, you make a sample out of it and you test it. But this disaster forced the engineers to develop such a machine wherein, instead of building a sample out of a material that is desired to us, we built the whole sample, or we built the old component that we will be putting into the application, and we will be testing before putting into the application, we will be testing it. So your machine should be sophisticated enough in order to encompass the whole of the component, and it should be, the loading conditions should be appropriate enough, you know, to impose the particular load on the component. So this was a final development in the history of material testing. Now, before winding up this lecture, I just wanted to mention one development that happened in Germany around the same period when there were commercial machines being developed in USA. So this happened in the year 1852, when to cater the needs of Bavarian Railway Commission, a first horizontal testing machine was developed. And for that time, this the 110 capacity was used, and this was the first ever horizontal testing machine. More than the capacity or its importance at that time, this approach of horizontal testing machines, it paved the way for the subsequent great machine of material testing, which could impose or handle a load of 3,000 tons. Now, even though it is said that US also wanted to build such machines, but due to some discussion, they finally dropped that idea. But there was such a machine of handling 3,000 tons, which is still which is, you can, if you want, you can have a look at that machine, which is still in Dusseldorf, Germany. And this 3,000 ton great or mammoth of a machine that could impose a load of such quantity, it was motivated by the simple horizontal testing machine of the capacity of 100 tons. The mechanism that is involved in this great machine is just adapted from the first horizontal testing machine. So at the end of progress of this material testing, it is important to note that with the demand of the materials, the focus of the material testing changed, or the focus of the building the right material testing machines changed. To just to recapitulate, the initial focus was on how much of a load could a machine handle. Then what kind of a mechanical condition could a machine handle? Is this machine only capable of introducing tensile loading, or is this machine can also include compression loading, or is this machine can also include torsion? So there was a shift in the focus. And after a while, what sort of a machine is this? Is it an horizontal machine, or is it a vertical machine? Or can what sort of a sample can I feed in? Was the focus of material testing. And after a while, we came into the precision aspect of it and the universal aspect of it, wherein in a single machine, you can get a very good precision, like the one achieved by A.H. Emery, and we could also have all sort of mechanical conditions that can be imposed in a single setup. So I would like to wind this lecture with this wonderful quote again from the works of C.H. Gibbons. What this quote states that whatever machines, that testing machines particularly, if you have the chance of looking at them or working on them, well, the one thing that you should remember is that there is nothing novel or new in the fundamentals behind that testing machine. Everything that the machine that you are operating, particularly the testing machine that you are operating, has been for a while now, and it has come about in order to respond to a particular material need for a particular purpose. And that is what C.H. Gibbons concludes his work with, and that is how I want to conclude this lecture on. So I hope more than the technical aspect of this, you find this lecture interesting. I hope more that you are able to relate the technical aspect of this course to the practical aspects or the practical demands that we would like to meet through this course. So thank you for your attention, and we will see ourselves in the next lecture. Bye.